Hello! If you want to know what LoRA is and how it helps us to fine-tune huge language models such as GPT-3 or Llama, then this video is right for you. LoRA is short for low-rank adaptation and comes in really handy because the cool chatbots and language models that we have been using, such as GPT-3, ChatGPT, Llama 2, Claude, Falcon and so on, are very general purpose. Prompting them correctly by asking the question right, plus showing them some examples in the input, only gets us so far and usually works for domains that the model has already seen in pre-training. To really specialize them for a task, or to a different domain to make them become a banking chatbot and get financial skills, or a medical chatbot, we want to fine-tune them on our smaller dataset, such as, I don't know, transcripts of videos from this channel if we want a llama model to impersonate Miss Coffee Bean. But when fine-tuning large language models, at least the open source ones, which we can download, we quickly run into a problem with their size. Highly capable large language models are huge because they contain tens to hundreds of billions of parameters. And during fine-tuning, we need to load all of these parameters in our GPU, just like for inference. But we also need roughly double the amount of space to save the respective gradient for each parameter. Just as a reminder of basic neural network training, we need the gradients during backpropagation to adapt the weights according to the loss we computed on instances from the new task. But with LoRA, we can fine-tune large models with only a fraction of the cost. LoRA was introduced by this paper from Microsoft and is surprisingly less complicated than we expected, and we'll explain it. It works like this. With LoRA, instead of modifying all these models' weights during fine-tuning, we freeze them, meaning that we leave them unchanged and do not do anything to the copy of the downloaded model. Instead, we add a separate set of weights. These fine-tuned weights, after an ideal LoRA training process, represent the differences we need to add to the pre-trained parameters to make the model perfect for solving the fine-tuning task. But come on, what did we do? We now have doubled the number of parameters on our hard drive. Yes, but it is double the amount on our hard drive and not on our GPU, because on our GPU, when we load the fine-tuned model for inference, we add the fine-tuned weights to the pre-trained weights, so we still have one set of weights for inference in our video memory, not two. The fine-tuned weights can be seen as modifications to the original weights, which we can merge into the model if needed. Okay, so during inference, we did not increase the need of memory for our GPU, but how do we fine-tune the network and adjust these additional difference parameters, and how can this be more efficient, since their number is the same as the original number of parameters so far, right? Well, this is the trick in LoRA. It reduces the number of trainable parameters. How? Well, you maybe know that a layer in a neural network is a matrix multiplication to the input of the layer, plus the addition of a so-called bias vector, followed by a nonlinear operation. The weights of the network are the entries of the matrix, which are the numbers we need to adjust in training or fine-tuning. The larger the numbers of parameters, the larger the matrices, so GPT-3 with 175 billion parameters has much larger matrices than GPT-2 of only 1.5 billion parameters. Now, every matrix has a rank, which is a number counting how many linearly independent columns the matrix has. Linearly dependent means that we can get that column by combining other columns from the matrix. And if we remove linearly dependent columns from the matrix, we reduce the matrix dimension, but without losing information, because that information was already there since we can get that linearly dependent column from other columns in the matrix. So LoRA's idea is that we do not need to optimize the full rank matrices that have high dimensions, there's a lot of numbers, but rather we should do a low rank decomposition by representing these weights as the multiplication of two matrices A and B. We gain computational efficiency because A and B together contain less numbers than the original weight matrix. In this example, we have 6 numbers instead of 9. Thus, there are less numbers we need to tune. And the bigger the original weight matrices, the higher the gains from doing this decomposition to a low rank are. The effect of writing delta W as a multiplication of two smaller matrices A and B is that we reduce the dimensionality of the weight matrix through A, thus we remove linearly dependent columns, and we regain the original dimensionality through B again. The hyperparameter we need to choose is the rank R, because we do not know what the intrinsic rank of the weight matrix is, and we implicitly remove, hopefully, linearly dependent columns by the AB decomposition. If we choose the rank too low, we reduce the dimensionality too much and lose information because we implicitly deleted linearly independent columns. If we choose it too high, we keep too many parameters that are linearly dependent and waste computation. We initialize A from a Gaussian distribution and B with zero and let backpropagation figure out what the right numbers in the matrices A and B are according to our fine-tuning objective. So LoRA in a nutshell means that instead of tuning the large weight matrix delta W, we tune the smaller matrices A and B. Told you that it's not super complicated. So after we've found the fine-tuned weights by optimizing A and B, we should not forget to add them to the original model to make inference with the LoRA fine-tuned model, and we're done. But why choose LoRA and not other approaches that adapt models in a parameter and compute efficient way? One common alternative to LoRA is adding so-called adapter layers in each transformer block. During fine-tuning, we only adapt these parameters of these layers and leave the rest unchanged. Since these adapter layers have very few parameters, even as few as 1% of the transformer's feed-forward layers, it means that during training it is very compute efficient. But the problem is that large networks are usually parallelized on hardware, while adapter layers must be processed sequentially. This means that during inference, adapters introduce a noticeable latency. Another common approach is prefix tuning, which is a continuous and automated version of prompt engineering. Instead of manually choosing the right words for the inputs to prompt the model to give the right answer, prefix tuning bypasses the word representation step. We add input vectors that do not stand for any words in particular, they are just vectors that we initialize randomly and we are calling them prefix. We tune the entries of these vectors with backpropagation until the model delivers the correct answer. Compared to prompt engineering, where the vectors represent words, in prefix tuning they do not. The problem with prefix tuning is that it occupies part of the sequence length and reduces the size of the effective input, just like with prompting. Also, prefix tuning is difficult to optimize and the number of trainable parameters is hard to choose. If you delete parameters, the performance can unexpectedly improve, but also vice versa, there is not a clear law. So sure, adapters or prefix tuning are still very popular, but since LoRA came out, it has been only increasing in popularity over the alternatives. And this was our little introduction to LoRA. Do not forget to hit the like button if LoRA is clearer to you now after watching this video. We hope to see you next time, so subscribe. Okay, bye.